There were times when I stumbled and I wondered, but every choice and every path I don't regret, for I have lived and I have loved like no other. I won't fear what lies ahead. There are scars and there are battles, this I know. Cause I'd be lost, but no matter where I go, they will one day lead me home. They will one day lead me home.
So, Rick, you always prove why you're the music director here. Well done again. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, our theme this month is freedom. And the statement for this month, when you realize what freedom really is, and that you already are free, experiencing freedom can come easily, effortlessly. Can come easily, effortlessly. The first step was understanding what the heck is freedom. And the second step was some understanding about that thing that makes it easy and natural and effortless. And today, are you really free? Is there any area of life, I want you to think about this, is there any area of your life wherein you feel imprisoned, trapped, choiceless? If you let go of the idea of trapped, you can choose anew. That's the trick. If you can let go of feeling trapped, you can choose anew, and by choosing, you've exercised your freedom. A greatest gift given to humanity was choice, volition, free agency. How do you exercise it? Do you exercise it to keep yourself in the prison, or exercise it to move forward and out into the evolution of the spirit called by your name? Eventually, we shall understand that all human bondage is an invention of ignorance. I shared this quotation last week. Ignorance is merely not knowing. We are only enslaved because we don't know otherwise. So here's the measure. I define freedom as a state of complete well-being, resulting from the level of our understanding of the principle of freedom, choice. The level of our understanding about choice is that everywhere, everywhen, every single moment, no matter what it looks like, those times when we think we are not at choice, those times when we feel at the effect of stuff, we still remain at choice. We still have a choice. When your mind is running you crazy at 3 o'clock in the morning, you still have a choice. Do you spend the majority of your time living in a state of complete well-being? the majority, I mean, even 51%, is way better than a lot of people who I have talked with. Do you ever think you are at the effect of something? Do you ever feel like you are at the effect of something? Another word for that is a victim. If you're at the effect of a cold, you're a victim of the cold. If you feel like you're at the effect of the government and its choices, because you forgot that you are the government, then you are a victim of the government based on your definition of your relationship with it. Every single situation in your life that you think you are at the effect of is the moment you have chosen to think that you are a victim of something or someone. What liberation to know that you still have a choice when it doesn't seem like it. Epictetus, last week I shared this as well. What concerns me is not the way things are, but rather the way people think things are. So, how do you think things really are? Really, how do you think things really are? Is life glorious, magnificent? Do you have all these options, all these alternatives? So choice is the first principle, and it's the principle behind freedom. And the behind is an important piece. In having a choice, we have no choice. There is one thing you do not have a choice about. You have a choice. Oh, wait a minute, if I have a choice, then I can choose not to have a choice. Well, you just made a choice not to exercise your choice, or you opted to stay with things the way they are instead of looking for alternatives and exercising those other choices. The only thing we don't have a choice about is choice. Emma Curtis Hopkins, who was one of Ernest Holmes' teachers. I always get what I'm praying for whenever I'm praying for is also what I'm praying from. There's your from. Are you praying from knowing you have a choice and that you can choose and put your attention on this? Use that other gift we have called will, our ability to focus on something? Are you focusing on that and coming from that in your prayer? In your prayer work, in your decisions every single day. And Ernest Holmes paraphrased a little differently, I can always count on everything in my life to work the way that I am working it. So constantly, those of you who have been in classes, workshops, and what have you with me, even from up here on the platform, you've heard me say, it's important we work this stuff. Ernest Holmes said, inspiration without application is hallucination. It's important we work this stuff, which means we need to understand it so we're not ignorant about how it works. Sometimes it happens quickly, sometimes it takes a little longer. So, about a year ago, a little over a year ago now, Jen and I bought a Class A motorhome, a coach. And we had planned to do traveling and all that kind of stuff, and then came up here and started doing this work. And so that slowed down the travel a little bit, but we went out a couple of trips and what have you, and every time we went on these trips, we regretted not being able to have a tow vehicle that we could hop in and drive wherever we wanted to go. And so if we needed a car, we'd rent a car in the town wherever we were. Pain in the butt. We wanted our own tow vehicle. So I started researching about, and it's been close to a year ago now, started researching that the single best tow vehicle was a Jeep. Because you could disconnect the drive crane like that, simple. Whereas other vehicles, you try to tow them, and what you do is destroy the drivetrain, you destroy the transmission, you destroy the engine. It doesn't work for many cars in today's world. Now you can go back and get a 1962 Volkswagen and you can tow that And you just put it in neutral and it's all good. You can even unscrew the odometer cable real easy. It's right under the forward hood, the trunk. Today's vehicles are not designed that way. And having owned a Volkswagen when I was in high school, I was very clear I did not want to contribute to the education of my chiropractor's great-grandchildren. Because that was my experience of the seats. So I've been researching these Jeeps and finally settled on two possibles, a Sahara and a Rubicon. And the reason for that is both, you can have six-cylinder engines, both have 8.4-inch navigation screens, both have wells and bissels that make you feel comfortable in this vehicle, and I can tell you, absolutely guarantee you, if it ain't comfortable, Jan's not interested. I'm a boy, I got no better sense. And so I don't mind a little bit, but it's also a better idea not to go all that time. I mean, I've lost an inch already. Why would I want to lose more from etc. So, did all this research. We're out running errands yesterday. Pulled into South Salt Lake, Chrysler, Jeep, Fiat. I think they saw something, Dodge. And wanted to test drive a Sahara and a Rubicon to find out if we really did want one, because all I had was notions of, I've been in Jeeps, but they were the old Willys version, where you definitely go even on a smooth highway. So we test drove these things. About 5:45 that night, we signed the papers and drove home a Rubicon. Bright yellow. Its color is hella yellow. I went in there thinking, one, we weren't going to buy a car. Two, if we did, it was going to be a white one with black accents. And we walked out, no, we drove out in a new Jeep. I can always count on everything in my life to work the way that I am working it. Jan has noticed something different about me compared to other people she knows, and that is, if I get an idea in my mind, I start working it. I don't talk about it a whole lot necessarily, but I do the research, and I think about it, and I sort of imagine it and what have you, and then when I'm ready, I decide, and boom, it's done. I bought a house, boom, just like that. I sold that house, boom, just like that. Because I had done the work and I was ready. I was coming from, it's a done deal. Now I was unaware that I had a, it's a done deal, it's done from yesterday when we went in the dealership, but look at the evidence. It was very clear that I was ready. I was done doing that stuff. And it's time to get off the dime and go do something about it. It's time to apply the principles. So the way out of these challenges when you find yourself not feeling completely liberated all the time, when you feel stuck, when you feel at the effective, when you don't feel like you have an option, alternatives aren't obvious. When you find that you aren't living in a state, a complete state of well-being, suspend that conclusion first. And second, consider your choices. Now, I have discovered this. A choice, by definition, means there is at least one alternative. If you notice one choice and it looks untenable, I guarantee you there's an alternative. And if there are two options, then there truly are four. And if there are four options, there truly are eight. And so on and so forth. People, all we have to do is shut up for a minute, sit down, get out a piece of paper and start jotting down the options we have. It's going to be easy to identify the alternatives that are not optional, that you don't want those particular alternatives. You're not willing to pay the consequences of that particular choice. But at least you have it in front of you and you can see, oh my God, if I have 16 options here before you line through any of them, then that must mean there's 32. I just need to keep thinking about this, keep working on this, talk to other people. What are some of my options? And sooner or later, you're going to find one that's going to be better than ever you had imagined. Because that's how it works. When we work it from the point of view that alternatives always exist, from the point of view that I live in freedom, I could never escape freedom, then there you have it. Ernest Holmes, take your beliefs, I shared this last week, place them on the table, tell the truth about them. Your beliefs are what limit the options that you see before you. We limit ourselves with our beliefs. You may have heard something somewhere like, it's done unto you as you believe. And that is a fact. That's how things operate in this world of cause and effect. In truth, we really already are free. The price for feeling freedom, is learning to control our thinking. So, separate these two. There's thinking, there's feeling. Thinking drives feeling. And I have had arguments with shrinks who think that feeling starts, that the feeling is first. That's not my experience. I may not be aware of what the thought was, but my experience is that the thought precedes the feeling. Feeling includes emotions, but it also includes that visceral stuff that goes on inside of us, the bubbling inside our intestines, the thrilling of the flesh, the goosebumps on our neck and forearms. Those are feelings. Emotions are the decisions we make about them. So watch this. We have a feeling. We conclude that it means that's this emotion, when in fact it might just be a bad burrito. And we had this feeling and we connect that feeling to the emotion called loss. And so we start making up, that's loss. It might not be. You have other options. You remain in choice about how to conclude what that feeling means. We each have the freedom to be ourselves, our true selves. And since we have freedom, we can also choose to be our inauthentic self, our untrue self. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Yeah. We each have the freedom to be ourselves, our true selves, here and now, and nothing can stand in our way when we choose it. When we choose it, not if, when we choose it. So when you don't feel free, suspend that conclusion and consider your alternatives. Choose anew. That's the whole point of today, is the choosing anew. If you don't think you have a choice, call a practitioner. If you think you don't have an option, talk to a good, sincere, close friend. Or shut up, sit down, and write out your options. You will find one wherein you can feel free yet again if you don't feel free simply in the sitting down and writing out your options. Today, please, let's together choose freedom. Bless you. Let's pray together. So I choose to be conscious, awake, aware, that within me, within everything, within all of life, exists a power and an intelligence. That power, that intelligence, though called by many names, I simply will call God right now. And it's not the name I use, but my definition of the name that I become aware of. And I know God, this power, this intelligence, the very presence itself, as infinite in every regard, no limit. So that intelligence exists within every life. That power to do, to move, to act, to change things, to make a difference exists within every life. And I choose right now to become ever more aware of it each and every moment. And know that as I speak my word, as these beloved practitioners speak their word, and as the people who come and receive this word, that power and intelligence increases in each. So peace prevails. Harmony reigns. Joy. Wonder. A sense of awe about the beauty and hugeness of life. And that wholeness that comes from this awareness becomes automatic. Let this word be spoken. So as these words continue to be spoken for the individuals, I speak my word for this beloved community. And I feel what I call joy, a sense of lightness, an ease of breathing, an ease within my whole body that I call gratitude. Because I know that these words, having been spoken, have been taken by the law and already start coming into the experience of each claimant. So the choice has been made. And the letting starts happening. So I let this be. I let the gratitude build. And I let the smile form, knowing all as already complete. So knowing this, together we affirm it by saying, and so it is.